By 1960 or 61, I had finished my own personal work on polio, as well as anthrax, and was literally looking around for something else. But at the same time, I decided that I would leave the Wistar to complete my pediatrics training, including a year at the Great Ormond Street Children's Hospital in London. The reason I mention that is because before leaving, I had decided that I wanted to work on rubella, and it actually started writing grant proposals. But then a coincidence happened, which was critical both to me and to rubella. And that is that when I spent the year, or during the year that I spent at Great Ormond Street, an outbreak of rubella started in Europe, and was quite considerable in the United Kingdom. And of course, I saw many cases, both of rubella, but then later congenital rubella syndrome. This made an impression on me and reinforced my thoughts about working on rubella. Just parenthetically, I think it's useful to note the value of clinical experience to science. That is, it really gives you a practical point of view and an insight into disease that you don't get simply by reading books. Unfortunately, clinical scientist is becoming a rarer and rarer species. But anyway, during that time in the UK, back in the States, the virus was isolated for the first time in two laboratories, one in Boston and one in Washington. And of course, we read that news, and I was then working with a British scientist at Great Ormond Street named Alastair Dudgeon, and he and I decided that we would set up rubella virology at Great Ormond Street, which we did. And we were able to start studying the disease and both the acquired disease and the congenital disease. So that when I came back to the States, which would have been the fall of 1963, I was ready to start my own laboratory at the Wistar, focused on rubella. And Hillary was supportive of that. And so I set up the laboratory, and lo and behold, the epidemic crossed the Atlantic, and a severe epidemic, or pandemic as it was called, swept the United States in 1964-65, leaving behind literally thousands of damaged babies whose mothers had acquired rubella during pregnancy. Of course, it was something the popular press was talking about. And as part of my work at Wistar, and also my burgeoning association or reassociation with the Children's Hospital, I began to do diagnostic work. So that I was seeing both mothers and babies, mothers who were concerned about whether to have abortions because of intrauterine, because of rubella in them and the possibility of intrauterine rubella in their infants, and also diagnosing the congenital syndrome. That was, of course, a powerful experience. And it's just to cite one statistic, during the height of that epidemic, 1%, that is one out of every 100 babies born in Philadelphia, was congenitally infected. So this was a major, major outbreak. The good side, so to speak, of the outbreak was that it enabled myself and other workers to learn a good deal about the pathogenesis of congenital rubella and give us ideas about how to develop a vaccine against it.